Why don't you come on up here, sit near the front, so when it's time. Well, we want to welcome you today to the worship gathering of Southview Community Church. Usually on Sundays, I'll say welcome to the in-person gathering and also the online gathering. Well, today we're mostly online. We do have about 9 people here, and that's our tech crew. I want to say a word of thanks to Kyle and Nathan and Lori, who are helping us with that today. Pastor James, one of our staff members, usually leads that, but he's home making sure that he doesn't have COVID. And so many of you know we have one person who tested positive for COVID on Monday. And out of abundance of caution, we decided to cancel our in-person gathering today. So we're all online today and on Facebook Live and on YouTube. And we have our tech crew, my 2 kids, and in just a moment, Miss Jenny Britt, Kyle Britt's wife, is going to sing a song for us. And then John Dyson's here today. John didn't check his email. And he showed up and joined us for worship today. We gladly accepted him. And then we have Benji and Stan, who came in from New York and Illinois and didn't know we weren't having church. So we invited them in. And we're all social. We're practicing social distancing here this morning. But having said all that, we're just glad you've joined us in worship today. And so wherever you are, you constitute the body of Christ. Jesus said, where 2 or 3 gather in his name, he will be in the midst thereof. So we believe he's here today where there's 9 or 10 of us. We believe that he's in your living room or wherever you are today, maybe in your car, where 2 or 3 come together. God's Son has promised to be in our midst. As we prepare to worship today, like I said, we did cancel our in-person gathering, but we just want to remind you to connect with our church. You can send us a Facebook message on Messenger or email. Or the mail. It might take a while to get it, but just communicate with us in any way that works for you. If you desire to support our church financially, you can do so online at our website, www.southview-lovegoes.org. Or you can drop it by the office as God leads you. We appreciate your support of his kingdom. All pleasure, no pressure when it comes to supporting God's kingdom. We have a lot of prayer concerns for our church, and in just a moment, Jenny's going to sing a song about healing. We have a lot of prayer concerns in our church. Pastor Teresa, one of our pastors, is struggling physically. She's doing some better. Also, Pastor James and Laura, out of an abundance of caution for the COVID diagnosis, they're quarantining just in case they have it. And so pray for them. So today I'm the only one of our pastors that's here, but once again, we're grateful for everyone that's here to help me today. I continue to pray for the Boffmans. Their daughter Darla passed away this week, and Randy Buchanan, Pat Shuff, or some other prayer requests. And I know Kyle Britt's grandmother, I want to pray for her. She had surgery this week and has had some struggles. And let's pray for our nation and our communities. Everyone knows that our nation and is in a world of hurt right now. We need God's grace like never before. And so I'm going to pray. And then Miss Jenny Britt's going to come up, and she's going to sing this song about healing. And I would say to you today that Jesus is still the great physician of body, of mind, and of soul. And if you need healing today for a physical ailment, or if you need healing for your mind, or you're spiritually lost today, healing is still in the hands of Jesus. Let's pray and ask God to help us today as we enter his presence through his presence and glorify his Son. Father God, we're grateful again today for your great grace. I got up again this morning, and your grace, your strength, it got me out of bed. It gave me the power and energy to get up again and serve you. We're so grateful for your grace that begins at salvation. And while we were yet sinners, God, your son died for us. And that same grace that gives us strength in life, we're so grateful for that today. Now, Lord, you know about all the requests I mentioned, and I'm sure I forgot a lot of requests. But, Lord, you know what they are. And I just pray that you'll work in a powerful way. And for our nation, Lord, spiritually, we're in a mess, so to speak, God. And we need your great grace today. So, Lord, as we worship you today, may Jesus, your son, be glorified. Lord, may every word I say be what you want me to say. Lord, I am not here to deliver a sermon. I want to speak your message, what you want said through your servant today. And so I pray today that you will guide me in every word. Now, Lord, as we step aside, as I step aside, as we enjoy the song by Jeannie Britt, I just pray you encourage our hearts today and draw us closer to you. And may all the glory go to your son, Jesus. In his name I pray. Amen. Thank you, Jenny. That was a beautiful song. Healing is in His hands. You know, we always think that healing, the first thought we have about it is just physical, but it's not. It begins with our souls. When Jesus Christ comes and moves into our hearts by His great grace. Well, I'm going to say it today, like I say every week, because I depend on this truth. God is good, and all the time. Okay, yes, He is. Earlier this month, Israel and two other Middle Eastern countries signed a peace treaty. Since 1948, when Israel came back together as a nation, when it reformed in 1948, there's only been two countries that have made peace with Israel. One is Egypt, one is Jordan. Well, about 2 weeks ago, they signed another agreement between Israel, Bahrain, and the United Arab Emirates. And I smile because we had just begun a series focused on the life of Abraham. And the name of the peace treaty, what they're calling it, is the Abraham Accords. And I read that and I smiled. I wanted to just read to you what the peace agreement says. We recognize the Arab and Jewish peoples are descendants of one common ancestor, Abraham. And in that spirit, we desire to foster in the Middle East a reality in which Muslims, Jews, and Christians, and peoples of all faiths, denominations, beliefs, and nationalities live in and are committed to a spirit of coexistence, mutual understanding, and mutual respect. Wow. You know, for those who know the Bible and read the Bible or have even heard Bible stories, we know that the Word of God tells us that about 4,000 years ago, God appeared to a man named Abraham, and a relationship began between the two. God, in fact, made a covenant with Abraham, an accord of sorts, a treaty with Abraham. We read about it in Genesis. Let me read this to you, Genesis 12, 1 through 3. The Lord said to Abram, "Go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all peoples on the earth will be blessed through you." The Abraham Accords began with a man named Abraham 4,000 years ago when he began a relationship. Or I should say, when God came to him and invited him into a relationship with Himself. And so we've been looking at this idea, I guess it's the third Sunday, fourth Sunday, I'm not sure, about what the essence of relationship looks like. What is the crux of one's relationship? Or what should it be between God and man? You know, what's the essence of a relationship with God? Well, Abraham shows us that a true relationship with God is evidenced by one's love for God's word, for God's way of life, God's way to live, and through worship of God. In other words, showing love and expressing love to God in our lives. Abraham lived that before us. Now, I think there's a bridge that connects these three, both individually and the three together, cumulatively, if I might. And I believe that bridge is a prayer life, a life of prayer, a life of communicating, a life of communion with God. And we see that, and we saw that, and we see that in the life of Abraham. It's key, it's critical in our lives. I think it was Paul that wrote, we must pray without ceasing. We must be continually talking to God and even more listening to God. That's what we see in the life of Abraham, who continually communicated with God. And it was often, it was a part of his lifestyle. He reminds us of what I want to talk to us about today. Prayer is this: God's grace found face to face. God's grace found face to face. And because I do it every Sunday and I do it for a reason, for those who are with us today, I want to ask you to stand for the reading of God's Word. If you physically can do so, it honors God's Word. And I know we do that with our hearts and lives even more. But would you stand with me? We're reading today from Genesis 18, but I want to tell you about the first part before we read the passage today. God comes to Abraham. Abraham's 99 years old. It's been 24 or 25 years thereabouts since God had told Abraham, I'll make you into a great nation. And God shows up and meets Abraham and says to Abraham, hey, about a year from now, I'm going to give you that son a promise I told you about. Yeah, you've got this other son named Ishmael, but he's not the son of promise. I'm going to send you the one I told you through whom you would become a nation, or a nation would be built, and through whom all the peoples of the earth will be blessed. 1 year from now, that's going to happen. Talk about grace. A 100-year-old man and his 90-year-old wife are going to have a baby. That's what I call amazing grace. But that wasn't the end of God's great grace. God is preparing to leave, and he's headed down to the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. And here we read how Abraham, in prayer, seeks God's grace face to face. Reading from Genesis 18, the Lord and the two other men started on towards Sodom, and Abraham went with them part of the way. And God said to the two men with him, should I hide my plan from Adam? Was it God, the Son, the Holy Spirit, or was it God and two angels? We're not going to get into that today. But God is having a conversation with those who are with him. Should I hide my plan from Abraham? God asked. For Abraham shall become a mighty nation, and he will be a source of blessing for all the nations of the earth. And I have picked him out to have godly descendants and a godly household, men who are just and good, so that I can do for him all that I have promised. So the Lord told Abraham, I have heard that the people of Sodom and Gomorrah are utterly evil, and that everything they do is wicked. I'm going down there to see whether these reports are true or not. Then I'll know. So the other two went on towards Sodom, but the Lord remained with Abraham a while. And Abraham approached him and said, will you kill good and bad alike? Suppose you find 50 godly people there within the city. Will you destroy it and not spare it for their sakes? That wouldn't be right. Surely you wouldn't do such a thing, to kill the godly with the wicked. Why? You would be treating godly and wicked exactly the same. Surely you wouldn't do that. Should not the judge of all the earth be fair? And God replied, if I find 50 godly people there, I will spare the entire city for their sake. Since I have begun, continued Abraham, let me go on and talk to you, God. Let me speak further to you, Lord. Though I am but dust and ashes, suppose there are only 45. Will you destroy the city for lack of 5? God said, I will not destroy it if I find 45. Suppose there are only 40. God replied, I won't destroy it for 40. Please don't be angry, Abraham pleaded. Let me speak. Suppose only 30 are found there. I won't do it if I find 30. Abraham continues, since I dared to speak to God, let me continue. Suppose there are only 20. And God said, I won't destroy it for the sake of 20. Finally, Abraham said, Lord, please don't be angry. I will speak but one more time. Suppose only 10 are found. And God said, for the sake of 10, I won't destroy it. And the Lord went on his way when he had finished with his conversation and with Abraham, and Abraham returned to his tent. Father God, thank you for the reading of your word. I am struck even now in this weird setting with 10 people here talking to a camera of the power of your grace. John Newton said, amazing grace. Boy, how right he was. We love you today. We need you. Please use this message to change me and to change every person by your great grace. I pray it all, and I know you hear me because of your Son, Jesus Christ. In his name I pray. Amen. Thank you for those 9 in person. You may be seated. And if you're home and you happen to stand up, you can go ahead and get back in your lazy boy. In 2009, I was blessed to be able to visit Israel, the Holy Land. And while we were there, we went to an area called the Dead Sea region. The Dead Sea is the Salt Sea, also known as the Red Sea. This is the region that many believe would have been the region of Sodom and Gomorrah and the 5 cities of the plains, of the plain. Genesis 19, if you read on, goes on to tell us that God destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities of the plain. He did it because of their great wickedness. Now, a lot of people will say, oh, that's just a story. No such thing as Sodom and Gomorrah. In the 60s and 70s, and numerous times in the 20th century, archaeologists have excavated in that area, and they have discovered there were 5 cities. Only 5. Well, the Bible tells us that. And it's clear that a catastrophe of some kind of fire destroyed these cities. Not only that, they in their studies of this area, in their discoveries, they found shafts in the whole region used to bury the dead. And they estimate somewhere around 1.5 million people, the human remains that they found there. The story of Sodom and Gomorrah, God's judgment on evil, cannot be ignored. The Bible clearly teaches that God will judge those who reject Him and refuse to repent and turn back. But you know, most people focus on the destruction of the cities. That seems to be the front story for them. But do you know there is a back story? And God wanted the backstory, the story of grace, to be the front story. It's the story of Abraham interceding, pleading in prayer for God's grace to be accomplished, to be seen. He was face to face with God in prayer, seeking God's grace. So I want to begin today. We just have 3 simple truths today. I think there's just 3. That I want to share. In Abraham's prayers for Sodom and Gomorrah, we see the unfathomable, immeasurable power of God's grace. Abraham says to God, basically, if you can find 10 people who are righteous, isn't your grace powerful enough to save them from this catastrophe and spare the entire area, these cities? Well, let's just take for a moment. Let's just say the 1.5 million inhabitants would be right. I'm a numbers guy. I haven't been in banking for a number of years. So I decided to come up with a percentage. So I took the number 10 and I divided it by 1.5 million. Here's the percentage. 0.00000667%. God's grace is powerful. That's my point today. You know, God is willing, yes, to save Lot and his family. We know that Abraham's nephew's living there. But God also wants to save the wicked. He wants his grace to save the whole people. And why else would we read in John 3:16, for God so loved the world Every person in it, individually and together as the world. And we read in 2 Peter 3 of God's great grace, God is not willing that anyone would perish, but everyone would come to repentance. Power of God's grace. You know, sometimes we see God, people want us to see God as this judge, and he is the judge. But he's up there with a Southern-style fly swatter, wanting to whack us whenever we get it wrong. Oh, God is a God of judgment. He is. We'll talk about that a little bit later. But God is a God of great grace. And if he's willing, oh, my land, for 10 out of a million and a half. Yes, the back story should have been the front story. The power of God's grace. Both for individuals and as people groups. Someone once said that God would have to apologize to Sodom and Gomorrah if he didn't punish the United States of America. Well, I don't know who said that. Interesting statement. I will say this, that in the United States of America, wickedness abounds. Evil abounds in our land. And it's increasing. But grace is greater than evil and sin. Romans 5:20 says, where sin is great, where sin abounds, where wickedness is overwhelming, grace is greater. Grace is more. The more the sin, the more the grace. God's powerful grace is greater than our greatest sin individually and as a nation. Oh, God willing to spare the cities for 10 people. I decided to try something. Numbers going through my mind. I don't know the exact population of America. I use the 350 million number. 0.00000667 times 350 million is 2,300 people. So God's great grace was available to Sodom and Gomorrah. It was available to each individual, and it's available to the United States of America and you and me today. For the most part, I stay away from politics in my preaching. You say, why do you do that? Well, if I meet a person who is not a Christian, and they are a strong political person, whether it's Democrat or Republican, if I am of a different political persuasion than they are, and my first conversation and argument is about politics, it separates immediately. They will put a wall up in front of me. And so I might win the argument or might not politically, but guess what? I don't get to talk to them about Jesus because politics divides. And I am a follower of Christ who's called to be a minister. I speak for the King of Kings, Jesus. I am an earthly shepherd of the great shepherd, and my kingdom is his kingdom. And he said his kingdom was not of this world. And when I talk about truth, and if politics comes into it, and sometimes it does, I want to speak the truth in love. I want, when I'm done with the conversation, that person to still know, well, Pastor Bill has grace, and he loves me, and I might not agree with him spiritually, and I might not agree with him if we happen to get on politics politically, but I know he loves me. So we must be careful to remember, as Christ followers, our kingdom is of Jesus' world. Having said this, and with politics aside, there is a sad sin in our nation that breaks my heart. It's called abortion. since 1972, 60 million babies, not blobs. 60 million babies have been aborted. Breaks my heart. How my heart is broken for those lives that never got to experience what God's plan was for them. And my heart breaks for those mothers out there who've chosen abortion. But we're living in days where it's getting crazy, folks. The Virginia governor said last year, or year before last, in an interview, well, he basically said this: the baby might be born and we'll just keep it comfortable, and the mother will be allowed to choose whether to end the life or keep it. Are you kidding me? By the way, the governor of Virginia is a Democrat. But wait a minute, don't tone me out yet. In 1972, when Roe versus Wade was decided, 6 of the 7 justices that approved it were appointed by Republican presidents. Uh-oh. Can I say it to my wife? Uh-oh, spaghetti. Oh. Why am I saying that? Because God's grace is the need of the hour. God's grace is the need in the individual lives of Americans. God's love, kindness, mercy, and grace is what America needs. Because when sin abounds individually, and I've been there, when sin was abounding in my life and God's grace came, and when it abounds in a nation, God's grace is greater. The USA, like Sodom and Gomorrah, is wicked, but God's grace was then and is now greater. It seems to me that we ought to be seeking God in prayer for ourselves, for our families, and for our nation. Like Abraham, we need the power of God's grace, and like him, we gotta live it out personally. It's the second truth of the day. The power of God's grace must be active, up close and personal, up close and personal in our lives. It's this truth that it matters not who's in the White House, but who's in our house. Who lives in our heart? Is God's grace? Is it a reality in salvation? Is it our lifestyle? Oh, God's grace is amazing. You know, Abraham intercedes. Basically, gets God down to 10 people. God, for 10, will you preserve the cities? Why was Abraham doing that? Well, there's multiple reasons, but I got one for you. Abraham had experienced God's grace personally. By the way, when God found Abraham in Genesis 12 or 13, we read it earlier, Abraham didn't know God, didn't know who he was. Abraham's worshiping idols, false gods. God found Abraham where he finds us before grace, in our sins, lost and alone. And so Abraham comes to God. He knows what God's grace is about personally. He knows how God's grace is so powerful and how it can change us and allow us to repent and turn our lives around and live in the power of the grace that saves us. Abraham knew of that. Oh, the power of God's grace for us individually, as a nation, and how we need it personally first. God help us today. Abraham had experienced God's great grace. And I love how Abraham had experienced God's grace personally, and how he showed it to Lot. Let me tell you about Lot. Lot is Abraham's nephew. When Lot's father died, Abraham said, "Come on, Lot, I'll take you into my home." Grace. And then Lot was taken into the promised land. God told Abraham, "I'm going to give you this land. I'm going to make you to a great nation." And Lot follows him there, and he continues to ride the coattails of his uncle. And Abraham even allows him to choose what land that he'll occupy. And Lot chooses the best land. And grace, God's grace flows through Abraham. Abraham blesses him, and then he takes the worst part of the property. And then we read on in the Word, you can read it in Genesis, how there were times that Abraham had to even go save Lot from wickedness from kings. You see, Abraham's had personally experienced grace. And he now is interceding. He's saying to God, "My nephew's down here, his wife and his two daughters." But he doesn't say that to God. He didn't mention their names, because Abraham's grace extends not only to Lot and those of his blood, but also to the cities. He doesn't say, "God, will you just spare my son Lot?" God's grace is flowing through Abraham. He had experienced it personally, and Abraham is interceding for his own, and he is also interceding in prayer for God's grace to intervene for his own and for all the people. You see, Abraham knew something that we often forget. Abraham knew what God's grace had done in his life. He knows where God found him. Idol worshiper, sinner. He knows of all the mistakes he's made. You want to read about that? Read about those? Read Genesis 12 to about 25, the whole story of Abraham. He knew God's grace and kindness and mercy and forgiveness was there all along his journey with God. He understands that if it was not for God's grace, he would be just like those people that God's getting ready to destroy. Abraham knew the power of grace personally and in prayer with a broken heart. He sought the same grace for Lot and the people of the cities of the plain. I'll never forget the day I had a meeting with Lucy. I changed her name to protect her. Lucy was not raised in a Christian home. She certainly has good parents, but to my knowledge, she had very little understanding of Christian matters. A tragedy had happened in their family, which I won't state. This young, in her 20s, young lady came to my office, and I talked to her about Jesus. I talked to her about grace. She didn't have much understanding of the cross and the things that some of us do. So I explained about God's grace and about Jesus, his son, and she would end up accepting Christ. But I'll never forget a conversation that we were having, and I'm not sure if this happened the day she accepted Christ into her life, received God's grace, and began to live the Christian life. I'm not sure if it happened that day or in a counseling session. But we were talking, and I noticed that tears were coming down Lucy's face. And so I said, "Lucy, is something on your heart? You want to ask me something?" And she said, "Yeah, Pastor Bill." Tears flowing down her cheeks. "Will God forgive my abortion that I had a few years ago?" This little bit of emotion, you see, is not fake, because I relive it when I think about it. I started crying, tears coming out my face. I said, "You bet." Why was I crying? Well, I was crying for her brokenness. But I was also crying because I was the one who God allowed to tell her about his great grace. For you see, I had lived in sin. I had often in my life walked in my younger years apart from God. And God had took me back. I knew the power of God's grace. I knew it personally. And now she knew it personally. Leads us to the last truth today. The power of grace. When we know about it personally, must be passed to others through prayer and practice. How we live. You see, Abraham did everything he could do to bring about grace for Sodom. Talk about the power of prayer and living face to face. He lived in such communion with God. And of course, he'd been walking with him a while now. He had been on his journey a long time that he could even ask God. The word says that God and Abraham are friends. But he could even ask God to drop the number from 50 to 40 to 30 to 20 to 10. You see, he's passing it to others through prayer and practice. He persevered in prayer before God. He pleaded for God to spare the cities. So I say it today, God, help us persevere in prayer for our families, for our friends, for our church, for our communities, and for our great nation. Sadly, the people in the cities of the plain, Sodom and Gomorrah rejected God's great grace. They wouldn't repent. Repent means to turn their lives around. It means to turn to Jesus and receive his grace, and then to turn back from the lifestyle of sin that we might be living in, or the sin that has caused us to be separated from God. God couldn't find 10 people. The angels went to the city. You can read in chapter 19. The angels went to the city and got Lot and Lot's wife and his two daughters and got them out of the city. Couldn't find 6 more, and we don't even know about those 4 because God's grace intervened because of Abraham. Because Lot and the daughters and the wife flee, but Lot's wife turned back to look and long for the cities that she had become so inundated with. And the Bible tells us that God turned her into a pillar of salt. By the way, there's this weird-looking object near the Dead Sea. It's about 15 feet tall. It's a jagged piece of something. It's probably about, I don't know, the size of a tree, maybe 10 to 12 feet, 15 feet tall, and it's made of salt. It's this weird-looking pole thing that goes in the air. Guess what it's called? Lot's wife. God's great grace, the power of it, if we know it personally, and we're to pass it on through prayer and practice as individuals and as a nation. Oh, God, help us accept your grace, which will lead to salvation. Let us repent and turn back. But let me tell you something, God's grace is free. I read it this morning. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of Jesus Christ, God's grace, brings eternal life. God's grace is free, but it came at a cost that our minds can't comprehend, and grace must never be cheap in our lives. What do you mean, you're asking today? Cheap grace is talking the talk, but not walking the walk. Oh, you're saying you won't be perfect? No. But I'm saying the rule of our lives will be God's grace comes and saves us, and God's grace sustains us and propels us in life on this journey called the Christian walk. And if we get out of step, if we sin, 1 John says we have an advocate, Jesus, and we come and we confess and we say, forgive me, and we keep walking with God. But this idea of I've accepted Jesus, I've accepted His grace, I know Him, and then to transgress as a lifestyle His word, that is cheap grace. By the way, God has more attributes than just grace. We're heading to the end of the message now. Some people have said there are 5 attributes. Grace is one of them. In the cross, which you can see on the camera, I think, this morning. In the cross, we see all 5 of them. God loved. Attribute. God loved us so much, He gave His holy Son. Holiness. To die for unholy humanity, that through Jesus Christ we could be forgiven of sins and made holy. And in the cross, God's justice was fulfilled. The cross was an amazing act of mercy. And grace, which opened wide the gate to God. You know, we can't just talk about the one. You know, a lot has been said about why God destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. It's true. A lot of sins and sinful lifestyle permeated the city, but do you know what the root cause of the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah was? Unbelief. Rejection of God. Rejection of relationship with God. A refusal to trust God with their lives. In the words of Frank Sinatra, their song was, I'll do it my way. We must not forget that. And we must be careful not to color sin, to emphasize one sinful lifestyle over another. The word is clear. We have all sinned and fallen short of God's glory. But Jesus died on the cross. And by His great grace and through the power of God's Spirit, we can be forgiven and we can be made like Him on this journey of life. Our lifestyles will change when Jesus comes into our hearts. Have you heard this before? Being from the coast of North Carolina, where there are a lot of ducks, walks like a duck, quacks like a duck, must be a duck, quack. Some of you are saying, I'm a quack. God, help us not color sinful living. We do that a lot in the church. God, help us. However, it's another thing when sinful lifestyles become ingrained in a nation or the culture of a nation. What I mean by ingrained. When churches and nations reject God's word and accept lifestyles that God says are wrong and accept them as right. That's what happened to Sodom and Gomorrah. The perversion was so great there that in chapter 19, the angels came to Lot's house, and the men of the square, those who were practicing the lifestyle of homosexuality, came to Lot's door and said, we want those men who came in. It was God and two others. We want them. Let us have them. We want to have sex with them. But listen to me now. It was so perverse there, it had even affected Lot. Lot offered his virgin daughters. Well, let's stand there and say attack one group or one. No, perversion had entered those cities. The culture had stood against everything that God said was good, and I believe you would find all kinds of immoral lifestyles there. Happening in America. I don't want to embarrass him. My son, born between 22 and 23 weeks, was not a blob as we went to the NICU and saw him for the first time. He was a baby. Real living being. His eyes were fused shut. He had no nipples on his chest. He weighed 1 pound, 3 ounces. Life. America, God help us. When the church begins to make excuses and our nation begins to accept immorality, what is against God's teaching, that's where we're in trouble. We're in need of God's great grace today. Please hear me. I'm not here to condemn anybody. I know apart from God's powerful grace. I know apart from personally being saved because of God's grace. He saved me while I was a sinner and could care less about him. It is only by grace that I speak today. No condemnation. God's Son stands open arm with open arms today. To individuals today. He's saying, I don't care what you've done. I don't care where you've been. In the words of the Apostle Paul, my grace is adequate, is sufficient to save you. And he's stating to America today, come back. 400 years ago, the Mayflower sailed into this region. I don't know exactly when it landed in Plymouth, Massachusetts. But it was determined that our nation would be built on Judeo-Christian principles. It was determined that we would be a nation built on God. And God is echoing down through the last 400 years. America, come back. And he's doing it not with condemnation, with open arms. Just like Jesus did with a woman caught in the act of adultery. In John 8, you can read the story. All the religious folks, the teachers and leaders, the leaders in the church, so to speak, all those who acted like they had it all together and forgotten that God's grace is what it's all about. They brought this lady and says, we caught this woman in the very act of adultery. Let me break it down for you. She was having sex with a man that was not her husband, and she was caught in bed with him. And they each one had a rock in their hand because the law said that that person would be stoned. What do you say, Rabbi? They asked Jesus. And he didn't say anything at first. He got down there and started writing some stuff in the dirt. Boy, wouldn't you like to know what he wrote? I don't know. With a little humor today, he's making a list, checking it twice, going to find out who's naughty or nice. We don't know what he wrote. But then he stood up and he said, those of you with rocks in your hands, if you've never sinned, throw your rock. And the word says, every one of them instead of dropping their mic, drop their rocks. Meanwhile, the woman is down. And Jesus says, get up. Like, did you just see her, the grace and love? And she gets up, and I'm sure she's, where'd everybody go? And Jesus asked her a question. Where were all those folks that came here to condemn you? We read it in John 8. Where are those who came to condemn you? Didn't even one of them condemn you? No, Lord, she said. Now, this is the part that a lot of people leave off. Jesus had more to say. I don't condemn you. And here's the part they leave out. Jesus said, I don't condemn you. Let me paraphrase. I don't condemn you. Receive my grace. And go leave your life of sin. Change the way you're living by my grace that saves you today. Probably one of the hardest messages I've ever had to deliver in 20 years of ministry. But isn't the back story the best story? The front story. Through prayer and communication with God, beginning with salvation, we can tap into the grace of God. God's face is found face to face, beginning with salvation. His grace saves us and leads us through life. The power of His grace that can be known personally, that through prayer we must pass on to others and live in practice. I'm going to end with a story. I've shared it. I've probably shared it 4 or 5 times in the last 20 years. I don't know. It's so powerful, I have to share it again today. I'm pretty sure I've shared it here. It's a true story. I heard a Nazarene minister speak one time. Chuck Milhoff is his name. He was speaking at our district gatherings in Virginia. He told a story. He told a story of a Midwestern family from Kansas. The mother was a nurse. The father was a pastor. The teenage son, or 18 years old, 20 years old, came to his parents and said, Dad, Mom, I'm leaving. I'm moving to California. He moves to California not long after. Tells his mom and dad, I found me a boyfriend. And I love him. And we're going to have a life together. The mom and dad, first of all, were broken for their son that he was not following Christ. And he was not. He had not received God's grace. And they knew that he was going to be living in a lifestyle that they knew God's word says we shouldn't live in. And by the way, there are other lifestyles, plenty of them. But they just kept loving their son over the years. They would talk often. Mom would just love. Dad wouldn't preach. Just grace. Well, Chuck Milhoff met this young man while he was doing a revival in California, San Francisco. He was asking the pastor after one of the services about the man who was playing the organ. He actually was throwing off on him with the pastor because the man had feminine tendencies. And the pastor cut him off as they were having coffee together and said, let me tell you his story. The organist was raised in a Christian home. Dad, a pastor, mom, a nurse. He ended up marrying his life partner. About 10 years into the relationship, his partner got AIDS. He calls home one night, brokenhearted. Tells his mother, says, "Mom, my friend, my partner has AIDS. He's dying and I'm broken and I don't know what to do." The mother goes the next day. The young man's lover, friend, partner, husband, whatever he was at the time, he's dying. Mom goes the next day or gets online, whatever. Immediately buys a plane ticket to San Francisco. Flies out to be with her son and his mate. She becomes her son's husband or boyfriend's nurse. And she's there up until the time he dies, about a week before he dies. The son's boyfriend, lover, husband, accepts Jesus in his life. Calls in their son, says, "We've been wrong. We lived against God's word. I know that now. God's grace saves me. I hope that you will receive God's grace." Shortly thereafter, he died. The mother goes back to Kansas. Some time goes by. I don't know how long it was. The phone rings. It's the son. "Mom, can I talk to Dad?" "I'm sorry." Dad answers the phone and says, "How you doing, Jimmy?" He said, "Not good, Dad. I need Jesus. Will you pray with me?" And Dad leads Jimmy to God's grace, which saved him and gave him the power to turn his face to God and away from his lifestyle that God says is not right. And this Nazarene evangelist found Jimmy, and I don't know if that's his name, in a Nazarene church at a revival service playing the organ. God's grace found face to face. I'm almost done. If you're out there today and you're away from God and you know that you don't have a relationship with Him, His Son loves you. By His grace, He'll save you. Into America, you're not too far gone. We're not too far gone. God's word says that Jesus stands at the door and knocks. And He'll open the door if we'll open the door, He will come in. He'll come into your individual heart, our individual hearts and lives, and He'll come back into the door of America. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound, that saved a wretch like me, that can save you today and can save our nation. Let's pray. Father God, today we just praise you. Lord, you know that I struggled all week with this message. Now, I don't even know how long I've preached. Maybe it's almost an hour. Maybe that's too long. I don't know, God. But I've struggled all week with this. And the reason I've struggled has been, I want to speak your truth in love. Whoever's listening to this message today, I want them drawn to your grace. not driven away. So God, I know I'm not Abraham. Abraham was a shepherd, God. I'm not Abraham, but I'm one of your earthly shepherds. And today I stand for every person watching this message or listening. I don't know their names. I don't know who they are. I don't know where they are. But as one who's been changed by your great grace, your powerful grace, I offer a prayer for them. May even now they pray a simple prayer like this. God, I'm lost. I've sinned greatly. I have no hope within myself. I take your son Jesus, even now. I accept the grace and the gift of your son to save me now and to give me power to change and repent. And God, I pray this in the name of your son Jesus, my Savior, and for what he did for me at the cross. Oh my. And for our nation today, God, I admit I don't pray enough for my nation. So I got to confess that. God, we're in the middle of this political turmoil. We're in the middle of a pandemic. We're in the middle of a world that says what used to be right is wrong, and what used to be wrong is right. We live in a world where the church has become very divided, where even your body is lashing out. Members of your body are lashing out against each other. Today, as an earthly shepherd, standing only on your great grace and the grace of your son, I lift up the United States of America. Lord, I pray that revival will come. Lord, I heard a story recently of Billy Graham. Said that he was touring. He was on Facebook. He was in England touring some of the places of the great people of faith. And he went to John Wesley's house, and they showed him the whole house. And they showed these students. Billy Graham was studying to be a minister. And they showed these students a private place there of John Wesley's. Maybe it was his bedroom. Maybe it was his study. And the guide said, notice over here close to his bed, there are places in the carpet that are worn. And there were two narrow places. And somebody said, well, what is that? They said, that is where John Wesley knelt in prayer for hours a day. Praying. And we know, God, that through John Wesley, Charles Wesley, George Whitefield, and others, had a revival swept across the United Kingdom. The story goes that the guy got everybody back on the bus. They were missing a student when he did the count. And it was Billy Graham. So he went back into the house to find this young teenager or 20-something. He was not in the kitchen. He wasn't in the living room. He wasn't in the bathroom. So he went upstairs to this intimate place of worship of Wesley's in the bedroom. And he could see over behind the bed the top of somebody's head. And he heard Billy Graham pray, do it again. And Billy Graham had got in that place of prayer. And God, through Billy Graham, you brought salvation to many. Today, help us, Lord, as we come to your great grace, to follow that example. By your grace, seek you in prayer. Grace found. face to face. May it be so. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I want to thank you today for worshiping with us. Thank you for your patience. You know, it's been said, someone once said of me, if you ask Bill, he'll build the time, he will build you a clock. I hope and pray that you'll give me grace today, because I know it was a long message. But more than that, I pray that the truth of God's word will resonate through your heart and life today and throughout the next few days. And as we go today, in my final words, you know, we say grace when we eat our food. Somebody will say grace. May God's Spirit allow us to receive His great grace, and may say grace be the posture of our hearts and lives. You are loved. Thank you for joining us today. Have a blessed day. Bye-bye.